good morning, and welcome back to the sanctuary. You may not know, but this is National Back to Church Sunday, and all across the country, people from different denominations will be celebrating the end of the summer. Vacations are over, kids are back in school, and it's time to come back to church. So happy National Back to Church Sunday. Also, today marks the beginning of the 10th anniversary of our Jubilate Deo singers. 10 years ago, Troy and I got together and were able to form this group. There have been different faces, and I wanted to introduce a new face today. Our new baritone bass is Ben Morris. He comes from Marion County, and he's a recent graduate of Ohio Northern University. So we welcome Ben. He's got a great voice, and I think you'll appreciate hearing him. Also returning from Ohio Northern University is Shay Bolton. And Karen Finn and I are the original members of the group, and of course Troy is our accompanist. So we're glad to be back singing today, and it was a perfect time for our group to come in and celebrate and sing for you. So good morning, everyone, and enjoy the service.
He is exalted, the King is exalted.
Join me in the call to worship. Beloved children of God, in supplication and prayer, with intercessions and with thanksgivings,
we come to worship God
in hope and in humility, with joy and with concerns.
We come to worship God
in faith and in uncertainty, with questions and with conviction.
Let us worship God.
Please stand if you are able. Our opening hymn, Though I May Speak. And as worshipers, we acknowledge, O God, you poured out your love upon us through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. As it says in your word, for God so loved the world. And we acknowledge we are a part of that love that you have provided for this world. In this time and in this hour together, may our love for you be made known through act of worship. For we ask it all through Jesus Christ our Lord. And let us continue to pray together. Join me in the prayer of confession. Holy God, we confess that we are too concerned with our own peace. We seek the comfort of silence and ignore the cries of the oppressed. We are inwardly focused, missing your call to serve Jesus, your beloved Son. Forgive us, O God. Equip us to do your will and work for the kingdom of God. Amen. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. We acknowledge that God is faithful to us. He is faithful and just and will forgive us of our sins if we truly acknowledge them and truly do repent. This is the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This time, let us exchange with one another the peace of Jesus Christ.
Good morning. In your bulletin this morning is an insert about the peacemaking and global witness offering. The first sentence of our confession this morning, Holy God, we confessed that we are too concerned about our own peace. There are millions of people in this world that don't live in peace and that we can help. The peace and global witness offering will be received on October the 2nd, which is World Communion Sunday. Since 1940, World Communion Sunday has been an ecumenical celebration of our oneness in the Spirit and the Gospel of Jesus Christ, bringing churches together in Christian unity. The money we donate to this offering is used in a myriad of ways to help those displaced by famine, by war, by climate change, and by violence. For more information, and there's a lot of it, I suggest you can go to PCUSA, Presbyterian Church USA.org /peace-global. I did, and there are so many projects and programs going forward that it astounded me. The funds from this offering are divided thus: 25% to the local church, 25% to the presbytery, and 50% to global efforts to foster peace everywhere. For me, when I yearn for peace, I can only recall the hymn, "Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me." So let's begin it. Thank you.
Another good morning. First thing I want to talk about is there are going to be flyers available for anybody to take one of these, but it's Gymanfa. It's a Welsh name, and it's a hymn sing. And it says it's the 105th year. It's going to be on Sunday, October the 2nd at 7 in Gomer, at the Congregational Church over there on Gomer Road. The actual Welsh Museum will be open from 4 to 6. And then on the 1st, actually, there is a chicken barbecue from 4:30 to 6:30. So these flyers will be
the back of the church, Ken?
At the back of the church on the table for you, anybody that wants to take one. Now, following the worship service today, please join us in the Williamsburg Room for the Hospitality Hour, hosted by Cheryl. Tuesday at 6:30 is a session meeting. Wednesday at noon in the chapel is the prayer meeting. Also on Wednesday is a Bible study in room 219 at 3 o'clock. And then Sunday the 9th is the Kirkin of the Tartan at 10:30 church service. And if you've never had the pleasure of attending one of these, you're going to want to come because it's quite impressive. So please bring family, friends, whoever, to that. Does anybody else have any other announcements? If not, please bow your head in prayer for the prayer of illumination. Blessed Lord, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, to read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast to the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The scripture today continues with Proverbs. The first one is Proverbs 6:19, and it says, "A lying witness who testifies falsely and one who sows discord in a family. Proverbs 20:19, a gossip reveals secrets, therefore do not associate with a babbler. Proverbs 10:11, the mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life, but the mouth of the wicked conceals violence. Proverbs 15:4, a gentle tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness in it breaks the spirit. Proverbs 10:19 says, when words are many, transgression is not lacking, but the prudent are restrained in speech. Proverbs 18:21, death and lie are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you.
Take me back to the church in the
Welcome back. Thank you. That was very lively. You livened us up. Now I'll liven you up some more with my preaching, too. By the way, I already had two comments about my jacket, my suit jacket, relating it to the month of March or St. Patrick's Day. So if that's what you're thinking, somebody already expressed it to me, all right? So, and I don't know why, I just felt like wearing green, and maybe it's because the grass has been growing like crazy and very green, so this is good grass growing right now. Maybe that's what inspired me. But anyhow, we are here to worship God and not talk too much about why I selected a certain suit jacket. The reading from New Testament is in two places. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. Let us hear the word of God. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is good for the building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. Now we go to 1 Corinthians, chapter 14, verse 26. What should be done then, my brothers and sisters, when you come together, each one has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. Let all things be done for building up. Now we go to the main text for my message. James chapter 3, verse 3 to 12. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large and driven by strong winds, yet they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. So it is with the tongue. It is small, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of life, and is itself set on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse people made in the likeness of God. For from the same mouth comes a blessing and a curse. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives, or grapevine figs? No more salt, no more can salt water yield fresh. This is the word of the Lord. Well, the kindergarten teacher gave an assignment to the children. Take this blank white sheet of paper and with your large black crayons, draw something. Little Charles drew something and teacher came over to examine it, and it was a man shoveling snow. The teacher looked at it and noticed some talent and said, "Someday, Charles, you're going to be an artist." Charles Schultz. And peanuts. Now, words have power to shape and influence our lives. Positive words can bring positive results. Negative words can bring negative results. I was listening to a sermon by a preacher called Overcoming Negative Words. And he shared in his life how, as he grew up, his stepfather drilled into him these words, "I never amounted to anything, so you will never amount to anything. You're stupid and worthless." Sure, that's why he selected the topic, overcoming negative words, because he had to overcome that in his life to get to the place where he was, to be a preacher of God's word. The writer of Proverbs says this, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue." Now, the title of this message is "The Taming of the Tongue." So first of all, the tongue is a good indicator of the spiritual condition of an individual. The average tongue is about 3.3 inches long for a man, and for a lady, it's about 3.1 inches. The average tongue has about 8 muscles, so it's not just one muscle. And it's not connected to the muscular system. In other words, it kind of functions completely on its own. There's about 8,000 taste buds on the human tongue. And even though you think your tongue is not active when you're sleeping, that is false. Your tongue is still active even when you're sleeping. Now, it used to be that when you went to the doctor, one of the very first things a doctor would say, "Stick out your tongue." Now, I don't think that's true anymore. I don't know, is anybody, when they go to their doctor says, "Stick out your tongue." But it used to be, they wanted to look at your tongue. And why is that? Well, because if it was pink, it was an indication that there's a lot of good health in your body. If it was red, it was an indication of allergies. If it was bright red, it was an indication of vitamin deficiencies. If there were white spots on it, it was an indication of fungus. If there was black spots on it, it was an indication of bacteria growth. If it was pale, it meant you were lacking in iron. I did read that currently there's some industry working on trying to get people to do this online, and you stick out your tongue and there's diagnostics that are run by the images projected into a computer, and then that computer can give some kind of an analysis of the individual by simply sticking out your tongue for the camera and letting the camera work on it. Now, medicine may be going in that direction whereby you have these e-visits. You don't actually go to the doctor anymore, and we've seen a little bit of that in the past couple years here. But Jesus said, it's not what goes into a person that defiles him or her. Jesus said, it's what comes out of the mouth that defiles the person. He said, whatever comes out of the mouth comes from the heart, and those things defile a man. For example, out come wicked reasoning, murders, adulteries, immorality, thefts, false testimonies, and blasphemies. These are things that defile a man. But to take a meal with unwashed hands does not defile a man. So Jesus is taking on the Pharisees who made everything external and just basically said, if you didn't wash your hands and you ate a meal, you were defiling everything. And Jesus is trying to say, no, don't look externally, look internally. But what happens is when we speak, the internal sort of in a sense becomes external, because out of the heart something exists, and then that what exists will come out through the speech. So I remember in early days for me, when I first bought a car and had a car, in the 70s that you wanted to be sure your radiator was clean. And so it was common practice to flush the radiator. I don't know if anybody still does this anymore or not, but I remember vividly opening up the drain at the bottom of the radiator and then taking a water hose and letting the water go through the radiator. And so as it went through, you saw what came out. Sometimes it was a rust color, sometimes it was a little bit of muck. And you kept the water running until clear water came out, so that you knew that you had flushed out the defilements in that radiator. Now, in the same way Jesus is saying, when you open your mouth, it's a little like the bottom plug on the radiator. What's coming out of there? We can tell what's going on inside the heart by what comes out of the mouth and the tongue. So secondly, the tongue has great power. James will tell us of the power of the tongue. And the first image he uses is a bit in the horse's mouth. Now, I've never ridden a horse, and I don't know much about them at all, but most folks ride a horse with the bit in the mouth and the bridle and the reins. So there's control by the straps of the reins, telling the horse through the bit whether to excel in speed or whether to go to the right or to the left. Now, if I didn't say that correctly, you can help me with that there, Nancy, later, because I know you know a lot about horses. I don't. But I'll tell you this story. I went to a conference in New Mexico. It's called Ghost Ranch. Presbyterians have it, and there was a conference there I attended, and they allowed for people to do some of the activities besides sitting there taking in all the theological lectures and information about being a good leader in church life. And one of the things you could do was go ride the horses. And there was a gentleman that came up who I might say was kind of a hot shot. You could just tell he was a hot shot. He had all the answers, and he went to go ride horse. But I saw him after he so-called had ridden the horse at the meal hour. And it looked to me like he had been run over by a steamroller. And I thought, what in the world happened? And he didn't want to talk about it, but from what I understand, he got on the horse and immediately he wanted to show off and he told the horse to gallop. And I guess the horse obeyed, but he didn't hold on well enough. And so down he was thrown from the horse, and I saw him in a condition that looked like he probably should have gone to the hospital, to be quite honest with you. But you see, there's control there for the experienced rider of a horse through the bit in the mouth of the horse. Now, it's the same way, James says, with the tongue. The tongue is similar. It is similar to a rudder on a ship, whereby you have just a little inserted into the water, something that can be turned this way or that way, and then that will cause that ship to go either right or left, depending upon how you turn that rudder. So just a small item on the back of the ship can cause that ship, that large ship, to go in a direction one way or the other by the simple usage of the rudder. Then James says that the tongue can be like a forest fire. And I've never had experience being in a forest fire, but I certainly remember all the commercials that came on with Smokey the Bear trying to tell you how to prevent forest fires. Because once they get started, there are monstrosities to put out. And the tongue is capable of starting a forest fire. Now, I remember in my first pastorate getting together with other pastors, and I remember one pastor who was pastoring a very large church, he just kind of confessed, and he said, "Well, all I do around here is put out forest fires." He felt like he was a forest fire ranger because someone stirred something up in this quarter, and then another one stirred something over there, and the next thing you know, this group's upset, and that group's upset, and he says, "All I do is put out forest fires." You see, the tongue can do that. It doesn't take much. When the wrong thing is said, it doesn't take much to start a blaze in the church. So James tells us the tongue is powerful. Now James also tells us, thirdly, the tongue needs to be tamed. And I tried to reflect on this a little bit, and I said, well, here's my version of it. Taming is taking an animal that's basically born wild, wants to be wild, and stay wild, and try to get it to cooperate. And it's not really interested in fraternizing with human beings. That's taming. So we talk about taming lions, taming tigers, taming bears. Okay, because basically speaking, they want to be left alone, they love the wild, they're wild creatures, and they really don't want to be domesticated. And they really don't want to have closeness to human beings. So that's taming. Now, we basically train other animals. Because in those other animals, for example, like a dog, there is already a natural propensity or a natural desire that they do want some human companionship. In other words, they don't want to be completely, totally wild. So that's why you can train a dog, and we don't necessarily talk about, well, I'm taming my dog. Now, maybe some folks might have said that about me years ago because I had a Ridgeback dog, and they're about yay high, and they weigh 85 pounds, and they could give the appearance like they're a wild creature, and they want to stay in the wild. But that wasn't really true, because he was just a gentle puppy inside. But he was large, so people got a little bit afraid. But anyhow, this is the way one person puts it, and I'm going to just give you some technical jargon, because it sounds real sophisticated. It'll make the sermon sound sophisticated. Taming is the conditioned behavior modification of a wild-born animal when its natural avoidance of humans is reduced and it accepts the presence of humans, but domestication is the permanent genetic modification of a breed lineage that leads to an inherited predisposition towards humans. I think I already said that, but I wanted to sound sophisticated, so I quoted this individual. In other words, James telling you, your tongue is wild. It's a wild creature, like a lion, like a bear, like a tiger. So we've got to tame it. Now, the first lion tamer came to France in 1819, then in America, 1833. So people have been accustomed to this idea of lion tamers, and they've gone into other directions with it, like tigers or even bears. And I remember years and years ago when I lived in New England, I went to a place where they had trained, tamed bears. And the gentleman did an act with bears in the cage, very large black bears. So lion tamers, tongue tamers, no difference. The tongue is wild. Now, how does a lion tamer work? What do they do? Basically, they try to do just what's called modification, behavior modification, rewards and punishment. Rewards, food, good words, emotion, maybe pet them or something like that, so that the animal picks up on the idea of a reward. But then there's also the punishment aspect of withholding something, or this manner of speech. But in any case, it's that interaction between the tamer and the wild animal. Now, any of these tamers will tell you one thing. It requires a full commitment. In other words, you can't expect to spend just 1 hour with that lion once a month. You better be there every day around that lion, talking to that lion, giving that lion some food. And you better not be lying around. That was a pun. You better not be lying around. It was a pun. Okay. So it requires a commitment. Now, what do you think? Same about your tongue, my tongue. You better have a commitment that you're going to work on it. All right? Now, it also requires authority and submission. So when the lion tamer or bear tamer goes into cage, that lion or that tiger or that bear needs to know that the one who came into the cage is in charge. Now, if they don't know that, I would say the one that walks into the cage could be in trouble. Because there's no authority. There's no respect. So the animal has to have that idea of respect and authority. And then one other thing. Submission. In other words, this is what I want you to do, and you are going to do it, Mr. Lion or Mr. Tiger or Mr. Bear. It has to be, in a sense, just one way. It can't be two-way, because if you let any one of them get in charge, it may not go the way you wanted it to go in your act for the circus. And you might be yelling and screaming to get out of the cage. And every once in a while, something does go wrong with these acts. All right. So now you've got authority and you've got submission. So who's in charge of your tongue? Who's in charge of your tongue? Please don't say, I am in charge. Say, the Lord God is in charge. Let Him take control. And let you be like the lion or the tiger or the bear in the cage, responding to His authority and submitting yourself to what He says. Now, there's another thing that I think is crucial to understand. Because James comes across in his text as if, who can tame the tongue? Well, nobody can, so just forget it. But see, that's not exactly it now. You are required, and I am required, to tame the tongue. So you say, well, how in the world can you do this? Where do you get the power? Where do you get the strength? Well, I'm going to tell you where you get it. The same way the people got it on the day of Pentecost. On the day of Pentecost, the Spirit came on them, and the Bible says the Spirit gave them utterance, and they spoke. In other words, God's power is available to you and to me to control the usage of words and how we apply those words to others or even to ourselves. The power of the tongue is great. And fourthly, the tongue can wound or heal. The tongue can destroy or build up. The tongue can curse or bless. James tells us of its power. And the question becomes, what do you want to do with it? Do you want to take the tongue and let the words come out that those could be healing words for someone who's deeply in pain? Can you take the tongue and let the words come out be words that build somebody up? That's called edify, strengthen. Do you want to take the tongue and curse somebody out or bless them with your words? It's all in front of you. It's all before you. And it's right there in that thing that's in your mouth. That's 3.3 inches long for the men and 3.1 inches for the ladies. It's right there. Now, James is trying to tell us that it needs to be done. Because it's so powerful. Stop and think first. Stop and think first. And that's what James tells us earlier in his epistle. To be quick to hear and slow to speak. Now, sometimes it's the reverse. I get quick to speak and slow to hear. But James says, slow up with that speech and do a little more listening. And then if you do that, the wrath is not going to come. The anger that you maybe thought was there, it'll dissipate. Because why? James said, you were quick to hear and slow to speak. So the tongue, put it into the cage. Go at it. Be a tongue tamer. You can do it by the help and strength and the power of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. We acknowledge, O God, that our tongues can do a great deal of help and healing, and our tongues can also do a great deal of discouragement and wounding. Please help us, Lord, to use our tongues to bless and not curse. Please help us, Lord, to use our tongues to give honor and praise to God and to respect all, because we're all made in the image and likeness of God, as James says. Help us, O God, to tame our tongues so that our tongues will be found to be acceptable to you. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. In his name we pray. Amen. You're welcome to join in on the singing of Wonderful Words of Life. At this time, we are presenting to God our tithes, offerings, and gifts.
Oh.
Be pleased to receive these offerings, even as you would receive us, that both the offering and the giver would be pleasing in your sight and strengthening in the faith. To Jesus Christ be all glory, honor, and praise. Amen. You may be seated. We'll turn our attention to a time of prayer and see if you have any prayer requests. If so, please wait for the microphone to come, and please use the microphone. Our Heavenly Father, on this day, we acknowledge that you are the giver of grace, that you bestow your favor upon us because of your goodness, because of your love. And we are in need of thy love and thy goodness. So I ask that you shower your grace upon us and help us to find grace and mercy and help in time of need. For this is a time of need in our land, where there is considerable confusion, where there is mistrust, and yes, even corruption seen. We acknowledge that we are in need. And I acknowledge as pastor preacher that the one way in which the needs of the world are met are through the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ, so that the world might know him, and they might know him in the power of his resurrection. There are some, O Lord, that need that resurrection power, for indeed something has gone astray, something has caused them to be asleep, something has caused them to feel deadened. We ask that you release that resurrection power upon thy people, that your people, O God, raise up the heights of faith and trust in you. For those that we know who are sick and ill in body, we pray for the healing of their body. For those that we know who are weak, not just physically, but weak in the faith, give them a stronger faith. Help them through the time of trial so that the trial produces good results in their life. Whoever is in trial, O Lord, whoever is in a problem situation, we pray you will abide with them through it all, and out of it will come good things in their life and good relationships, and also a faith that's immovable, a faith that is powerful, a faith and a love that can move mountains. We do pray, our God, for each one who is in need. Whatever that need is, may it be submitted to thee, and may you, in your will, and in your plan and providence, hear their prayer and answer them accordingly. For all this we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We close with, Open my eyes that I may see. Thank you. So the hymns we sing are very powerful and very interesting, and this was an excellent selection. So, but if you happen to notice, it starts out with the eyes, then the ears, and then the mouth. So you see God, and then you hear God, then you speak. But also notice, too, in the verse 3, when we said, open my mouth, verse 3 starts, open my mouth, and let me bear gladly the warm truth everywhere. But then at the end it says, open my heart, and that's the same line, 3. So the mouth and the heart are tied together. So I guess this hymn writer was along the same page as I was. But it was a wonderful hymn. So go forth and speak the glad truth everywhere. Jesus Christ loves you. Jesus Christ loved the world.